My name is Mark DeSalvo. I'm the elected town moderator here in North Andover. Welcome to the annual town meeting of the town of North Andover, first established in 1646. I call to order the 2014 session. Thank you so much for your bit of patience. Sometimes technology makes things enormously efficient. Sometimes there's a little bit of a delay, and we've just experienced that delay. Each year, I try to highlight a contributing and deserving stitch in the fabric of our community by selecting them to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance. Please stand and join me in recognition of Older Americans Month, represented here by the proud members of our North Andover Senior Center, Priscilla Cole, Pat Long, Phyla Slade, and Peter Aziz, who will now lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America,
and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you very much. Please be seated. And thank you, ladies and gentlemen. If you'll allow a personal courtesy, it's important that I recognize some of the individuals who sat on the stage a year ago who have retired from service to our town. Please let me thank Tom Duggan, Bob Norbito, and Michelle Nadeau, who so successfully labored as members of the Finance Committee. And joining us on this stage for the first time are my new appointments to the FinCom, Susan Almano, Marta Soloff, and Tim Shearhart. Welcome and thank you. The simplified rules of parliamentary procedure are published in the town warrant, and an abridged version is here on the screen. We'll be displaying in real time all articles and changes to articles in an effort to make the meeting more efficient and keep everyone up to date and informed so collectively we can make better decisions. The rules remain the same as the past 2 years, with one small exception. Briefly, the rules require that one must, when speaking, come to a microphone and state your name and address. Sworn law enforcement personnel are relieved of the obligation of stating their address if they wish. The 5-minute speaking rule remains. Time remaining is indicated by the countdown clock, and you should stop when the time reaches zero. In isolated cases, I have and will use my discretion in extending time for the benefit of the meeting. The time limits include the moderator. It is not an invitation to use all of the 5 minutes. Brevity will be well rewarded with the number of votes that you receive. Each speaker has an affirmative responsibility to disclose if they or an immediate family member has a personal financial interest in an article on which they are addressing the meeting. This definition has been expanded to include in-laws. One does not need to stand and state that they do not have a personal financial interest. Nor do you have to state, if speaking about the town budget or using the ambulance service, for instance, that you are a parent or use the ambulance service because that is a financial interest, because these services are available to all citizens. Second, all town officials, appointed employees, and elected officials must disclose when they are speaking whether or not they are speaking in an official capacity. We can assume that the ladies and gentlemen on the stage who may get up to speak are doing so in an official capacity unless otherwise noted. Speaking of the stage, here displayed is a chart of those joining me to help conduct town meeting. They will introduce themselves when they have a need to speak. Thank you all for your contribution. I'm grateful for the citizen advocates who will be available to assist citizens with town meeting problems. If you need their assistance, just call out from the microphones or seek out any of the tellers, and they will direct you to them sitting here on my right. Our innovations of past years, we will be testing a new initiative, never before tried in any town meeting anywhere, allowing those observing the meeting live on TV or streaming live on the internet to email questions into the meeting under stringent restrictions. If you're watching and wish to participate, please go to the town's website, www.townofnorthandover.com, where rules, instructions, and access are provided by clicking on the banner about the town meeting. I've always believed the town meeting has two constituencies, those of us here in the room and everyone else who is affected by the judgments we make here in this room. All power, however, is in the room, for you alone have the ability to vote and to make motions. Questions and discussions in this room take precedence. Of course, those in the room need not utilize the email question option. I will have no input or knowledge as to who might ask a question and what it might be. Thank you for your patience in tolerating this possible glimpse into the future. We'll see together how it works out. I now recognize the chair of the Board of Selectmen, Rosemary Smedili. Rosemary?
Mr. Moderator, Rosemary Connolly Smedili, 65 Green Street, Chairman of the Board of Selectmen. I move that this meeting dispense with the reading of the warrant and with the reading of the constable's return of service of that warrant. I further move that the moderator not be required to read articles of the warrant verbatim, but be allowed to refer to the articles by number and by subject matter, or as displayed, and further that amendments need not be read, but are to be voted upon as displayed or otherwise provided in print to the voters in attendance.
Is there a second to the motion? All those in favor of the motion, any discussion, excuse me. All those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It so carries unanimously. Articles 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, we characterize them as consent articles. These are non-controversial, everyday housekeeping issues that we deal with ad infinitum year to year in our town meeting. And if you'll allow, if there is no objection, we'll be able to take them all as one. Is there a motion to move forward?
Mr. Moderator, move to adopt Articles 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 as printed in the warrant and displayed on the screen.
Is there objection? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Then we move on. Thank you. We're now cooking with gas here. Article 6, amended general bylaws, Chapter 88, dogs. Do we have a motion? These are the next 10 pages. Last year was the year of the chicken. This year is the year of the dog.
Mr. Moderator, move to adopt Article 6 as printed in the warrant and is displayed on the screen.
Is there any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? It carries unanimously. Article 7. Mr. Simons. Page 23.
Okay. Move to adopt Article 7 as printed in the warrant and as displayed on the screen.
Is there any discussion? All those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? It carries unanimously. Article 8, Mr. Simons.
Move to adopt Article 8 as printed in the warrant and as displayed on the screen.
Is there discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? It carries unanimously. Article 9, Mr. Simons.
Move to take no action on Article 9.
There's a move to take no action. It needs leave of the meeting. Is there objection? Hearing none, we'll take no action. Article 10.
Mr. Moderator, move to adopt Article 10 as printed in the warrant and is displayed on the screen.
Is there a second to the motion?
Second.
Is there any discussion? Please come to the microphone should you have a question.
On Article 10, what
Excuse
is the
Excuse me, ma'am. Protocol sorry. Is to introduce yourself, tell us your address, and then proceed.
Okay. Jennifer Goldman, 112 Amberville Road.
Welcome.
Sorry, I'm new.
It's quite all right. Welcome.
Thank
it's
you.
It's pretty painless, isn't it?
Well, so far.
Good for you.
What is the impact of approving this to be municipal use?
I think we can ask our town manager for that answer.
The purpose of transferring this land, and if in 1 second we'll display on the screen the parcel in question, I think will be helpful to the discussion. As you look at the screen above, to the left side of the track, from my perspective, is a rectangle-like structure, a lot of land. That is the proposed location for the new fire station. The school committee has voted unanimously to surplus this land. The Board of Selectmen has voted unanimously to accept this land. It now requires town meeting approval to endorse that action, and this will then become town-owned land for the purpose of building the new fire station that's proposed under the capital improvement article later in the agenda.
Are we satisfied? Easy enough? Good for you. Congratulations. Any other discussion? Hearing no other discussion, all those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed?
No.
I declare it a two-thirds vote, two-thirds being required. Article 11. Mr. Gordon. Is Mr. Gordon here? Does someone wish to, as a courtesy to Mr. Gordon, make a motion? It's not necessary to do so.
I'll move to adopt that as printed and as displayed on the screen.
The motion has been made to move the article. Is there a second?
Second.
Do we have any discussion, or would anyone like to explain for the benefit of the meeting?
This is what it is?
Yeah. Might be helpful.
The town will vote to petition the general court to enact legislation so that William Gregory.
We don't need to read it.
Shall be eligible. He is over the current age limit. There has to be a reason that he's not here this evening because he's attended everything in the past. But oh, my apologies. This is to petition the general court to waive the age restriction for police officer, so that he can be put on the. On the list, even though he's over age 32.
Selectmen have made a favorable recommendation. The meeting is free to do as it wishes. Is there any other, are there any other questions or discussion? Then we'll move forward with a vote. All those in favor of the article as presented and displayed, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed?
No.
I declare a majority as is necessary. Article 12, Mr. Manzi. Welcome, sir.
Good evening, Albert Manzi, 10 Foster Street. For disclosure purposes, I'm not speaking in an official capacity, as I do serve on a town board. I move that the article be adopted as printed in the warrant.
And displayed.
And displayed.
Thank you. Is there a second to the motion?
Second.
Motion is made and seconded. Would you care to comment, sir?
It's the same as the previous article. It's simply ineligibility. Motion so that I am over the age of 32, and I'd like to be considered for that position to the extent I can continue with that process.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other discussion or queries on the motion? Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed?
No.
I declare it a majority vote. Article 13. Mr. Nothnagel. You're very welcome.
Nothnagel. 92 Surrey Drive. Am I too close to the mic there?
Go right ahead.
Okay, thank you. I came back this year with a revised petition because, like many of you, I'm concerned that the millions of dollars coming from large, wealthy organizations and individuals of all political leanings are overwhelming our individual voices in the democratic process and facilitating the undue influence of well-financed special interests on our elected officials. This year's revision clarifies one critical point, and that is that this resolution would put the town on record as supporting a constitutional amendment that any entity, whether a business corporation, a union, or a nonprofit organization, does not have the same constitutional rights as human beings. This resolution applies to all entities that owe their legal existence to the actions of government bodies, and who in turn receive specific benefits from the government that are not available to human beings. Corporations, unions, and nonprofits do serve valuable purposes in society, but they are fundamentally different from human beings. They have interests that may or may not coincide with the interests of the people. And after all, the Constitution was written to assert and protect the rights of we, the people. I should also mention that the free speech rights of real people, real human beings, are sacred and would not change a whit if such a constitutional amendment were adopted. We sometimes hear that this may not have relevance, direct relevance to our town here. However, entities that seek favorable treatment here in North Andover might support the election of any candidate for town office who would support their interests. Selectmen, zoning board people, conservation committee, finance committee, they can, according to the Supreme Court's decision, contribute lots of cash to see that those people are elected, the ones that would favor their position. I want to also note that in a survey in 2012, 2 years after this Supreme Court decision, 66% of the small business owners who were surveyed believed that the Citizens United decision was bad for small businesses. 88% of those small businesses had a negative view of the role money plays in politics. Citizens United decision, if it is kept on the books without an amendment, is dangerous to local merchants, potential abutters, and to the town's finances. Also, to date, 183 cities and towns in Massachusetts, which is over 50% of the municipalities in this Commonwealth, have voted for such a resolution, including our neighbor Andover, who just last week voted for such a resolution, supporting a constitutional amendment. So all in all, if you believe that elections should be decided by the power of individuals' votes rather than the size of contributors' wallets, vote for Article 13. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Is there any other discussion? I see some people at the microphone, please.
Good evening. Karen Klein from Cricket Lane. As you just said, Mr. Moderator, all power is in this room. Each of us has a vote. That is human beings you were referring to, not entities such as PACs. And I also have a nonprofit of my own, and all nonprofits now, I have found out, are not created equal. I thought everyone was a benign, giving type of group, and it's not. Some of them are very, very much opposite that. And Citizens United opened the door to corporate, union, and nonprofit groups to overpower a citizen group coming together, as we've always done, to support a candidate or a cause. Please consider voting yes on Article 13. Thank you.
Thank you. Further discussion?
Hello, Elaine Almquist of 81 Adams Avenue. From a legal perspective, the Citizens United decision overturned centuries of jurisprudence. Corporate personhood was challenged in court several times before the 2010 decision, and each time the Supreme Court justices confirmed that corporations are different from real people. And this 2010 decision was controversial. Four Supreme Court justices dissented to the opinion, and I agree with that dissent. I encourage my fellow citizens to support Article 13 with a yes vote. Thank you.
Thank you. Sir.
Mark Nazina, 405 Johnson Street. Normally, I wouldn't get up to talk about a non-binding resolution, but I want to clarify a few things about nonprofits, first of all, because I think one of the previous speakers was a little bit misleading about what nonprofits can and can't do. 501c4 nonprofits cannot endorse candidates. They can't tell people to vote for or against candidates, and they cannot specifically align with a political party. 501c3 nonprofits actually go even further than that. They cannot show bias towards a specific candidate or another. So the implication that nonprofits are directly getting involved with elections is completely wrong. And that's in addition to the fact that most nonprofits are completely apolitical. If you go to a church, most likely that church is a nonprofit. The American Red Cross is a nonprofit organization. So I would urge anyone who goes to church, who donates to their church, who's ever volunteered for a nonprofit, whether it's one that gets involved in political issues or not, to oppose this resolution. I think it's a very dangerous path to go down.
Further discussion?
Hi, good evening. I'm Kim Adamai, 55 Maple Avenue. I am going to be supporting Article 13. Just simply, when I turned 18, for my birthday present, I went down and registered to vote. That was my present to myself. One person, one vote, and that is democratic. That's what I, that's why I'm an American, so that my vote counts. There is power in one vote. So when a corporation can come up and vote as a human being, that makes absolutely no sense to me. I can't support that. And being someone who's been self-employed for several years, it's important that I have a chance to have my business. I just want it to be fair, and for me, voting yes on this article is the most fair thing we can do. Thanks.
Thank you. Is there any other discussion? Hearing none, we'll move to a vote. All those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, say no.
No.
I declare a clear majority. I would like to... excuse me? If six other people join you. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. We will do a hand vote. It's necessary when I ask those people who are voting yes and then secondarily then no to raise your colored card, and the tellers will take a count. All those in favor, please raise your card. Are we ready, ladies and gentlemen, tellers? Are we ready, sir?
I believe so.
Thank you. Section 1?
34.
Section 2?
51.
Section 3? 51. Section 3?
32.
32. Section 4?
33.
33. Section 5?
11.
11. Section 6? Section 6, yeah, Section 6, so those people who have been kind enough to do all the check-in work. Chris? Two votes in Section 6 and Section 7?
13.
13 votes. Those voting no, please raise your card. I think we're ready. Section 1?
8.
8 votes. Section 2?
6.
6 votes. Section 3? 10. Section 4?
8.
Section 4, 8 votes. Section 5?
2.
2. Section 6? 2 votes. And Section 7?
7.
7 votes. a majority clearly reached, the issue has been passed. I ask your leave for... I've been told that I misspoke on Articles 11 and 12. It was my intent to say that they passed by two-thirds votes as declaration, which was clear, and I apparently said majority, so it will be recorded as two-thirds votes in Article 11 and 12. Article 14. Ms. Levin.
Hi. I move to...
Excuse me, your name
I'm
and
Nadine
your address,
Levin.
Please.
I live at 195 Amberville Road, and I move to the motion as displayed on the screen.
The motion has been made. Is there a second to the motion?
Seconded.
We'll start the clock again as soon as I finish speaking for the benefit of Ms. Levin. So you are aware the original motion is printed and it's been struck out as it's since been amended. That amendment happened prior to this evening, so that's now considered the main motion, but we wanted to give you the courtesy of knowing what had happened between the printing of the book and this evening. Ms. Levin, start the 5 minutes for her. Go ahead.
My name is Nadine Levin. I live at 195 Amberville Road in North Andover. I am a 15-year resident of the town with children who attend Franklin Elementary and the middle school. I am the owner of the mobile food truck, Pipe Dream Cupcakes. The intent of my article is to amend the bylaw with respect to mobile food truck vending locations. I'm asking for your support because a vote in favor of this article will enable me to continue to operate my business on Main Street and High Street in North Andover. As the first food truck in North Andover and the only one that operates around town with a regular schedule throughout the year, this article only pertains to Pipe Dream Cupcakes, since I had a food truck license as of the last town meeting, and I currently maintain that license. Any food truck that received a license after May 23rd, 2013, will have to follow any parking restrictions that the selectman enforces. My business launched 2 years ago, and after consulting with numerous town officials, including the Health Department and the North Andover Police Department, I was informed that I could operate my business in any legal parking spot in town. Parking on Main Street and High Street was a key part of my business plan. Being on main roads where there's walking traffic is very important to the success of my business. Since I was able to park in these areas, I deem North Andover a viable town to conduct business in and pull a permit. A vote against my article would have immediate and potentially severe effects on my business. If new regulations are put into place in North Andover, I will not be allowed to park in the current locations that I've been selling at for the past 2 years. For the past 2 years, I parked on Main Street 3 days a week for only an hour and 15 minutes, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. On Wednesday, I parked 30 minutes on High Street past Jamie's restaurant, well after the lunch rush from 3 to 3:30. This represents less than 4% of the time that most businesses in these areas are open. My vehicle is the equivalent size of an SUV and only takes up one parking space. There are no safety issues with my vehicle since the service window faces the sidewalk. Customers are not in any danger from any street traffic. I have all the proper licenses to operate my food truck, including my hawkers and peddlers license and mobile food truck permit. I sell only one product, cupcakes. I do not sell coffee, cakes, or other pastries, just cupcakes. And I'm committed to giving back to North Andover. Like many of the fellow small business owners in attendance tonight, I regularly donate to local community events and our schools, as well as state and national charities. I am proud to be a member of the North Andover Association. Besides the tax revenue I submit monthly to the town, I believe that Pipe Dream Cupcakes generates additional exposure and tax revenue to the town. Growing the economic development of North Andover is what we should strive for. I am constantly being told by thousands of my followers on social media that when they come to North Andover for a cupcake, they also shop in some of the other small businesses that are in town. These followers are not only from North Andover, but may come as far as Bridgewater and Worcester. They would have never known about these shops if my business did not drive them to downtown North Andover. I have support from numerous North Andover business owners, including Jamie Ferrara, who owns Jamie's Restaurant on High Street, and Chris Vasopoulos of J&M Subs and Pizza. on Main Street. I received a letter of support from Chris. Here is a direct quote. I believe Pipe Dream Cupcakes would only actually bring more people into the heart of the town. Residents of North Andover, I need you to know this is not a hobby for me. I was a business professional in Boston for 15 years, and before leaving my profession, I did the research and built a thoughtful business plan based on the current rules of the town regarding the food trucks, North Andover's foot traffic, and where my business would thrive. The decision made tonight will directly impact my business. I need your help. A vote yes from you will allow me to continue to park 4 hours a week on Main Street and High Street. Thank you for your time, and please support me and Pipe Dream Cupcakes by voting in favor of my article. Thank you.
Thank you. It's come. It's come to my understanding that the Board of Selectmen, unlike as stated, has taken a position on this article.
Mr. Moderator, the Board of Selectmen vote unfavorable action on this article.
And we have any other discussion, please.
Hi, my name is Kristen Pascucci. I live at 10 Glenor Circle here in North Andover.
Welcome.
I've lived here in North Andover for 8 years, and I could not be happier to call North Andover home. I hope that we as a community see that the businesses that we have here in North Andover make our town a more desirable place to live. The more choices we have for recreation, dining, and entertainment, the better. I love to be able to choose whether or not I'd like to get a cupcake from Pipe Dream Cupcake Truck or one from Good Day Cafe, just as much as I would love to get a black coffee from Dunkin' Donuts on Main Street in downtown, or just walk 2 blocks away and get a flavored coffee from Heavenly Donuts. If your product is a good one, you shouldn't worry who else is competing against you, whether they move next door or they park on a nearby busy street. When my children made their first communions, I used the businesses here in North Andover to help with their parties. For my older daughter, I chose Orzo, and I chose Tripoli for dessert. And for my son, I chose Butcher Boy for the meats and dessert. And for my youngest, I chose Orzo again, and I chose Pipe Dream Cupcakes for dessert. Having these amazing choices here in North Andover made my parties go more smoothly. I am voting yes in favor of the article to support Pipe Dream Cupcakes, which will allow her to park on Main Street and High Street, because Nadine Levin puts out a quality product. She runs a wonderful business, and she is exactly the type of business owner that we should want here in the North Andover community.
Thank you. Mr. Tripp.
Mr. Moderator. Ted Tripp, 262 Boston Street.
Welcome.
Could we get an explanation from the Board of Selectmen why they voted unfavorable action?
We can ask if they choose to answer. It's their prerogative.
I'm going to defer to Selectman Watson, who was the chair of the committee that put forth a plan referring to this particular article.
Background on this, last year, at town meeting last year, this board was tasked with regulating a new and emerging industry that was in town. It wasn't just the cupcake, there was a few other trucks at that time. And again, this body tasked us with that job to do. So these regulations have come from that mandate. What this board decided to do was to create a committee that consisted of, Board of Selectmen, which was myself, a number of business owners. Nadine was a member of the committee, community members, as well as the police department took place. Over the course of a number of months, we created, I think, a great compromise of regulations, again, that this body tasked us to do at last year's town meeting. When we brought forth those regulations to the Board of Selectmen, they were amended to include the entire strip of Main Street, not First Street, not Second Street, not Waverly, not Water, just the entire strip of Main Street as well as High Street. At that point then, which brings us here, to amend. Yes, the original, from the committee that was formed, the agreed upon regulations at that point did not include all of Main Street. It included from First Street to 2nd Street, where the highest concentration of activity is. And then the Board of Selectmen actually expanded that to include all of Main Street, but not the side streets off of Main Street. So does that clear it up for you, Mr. Tripp, as to where this is coming from?
Well, not really, because that explains your original regulations for it, but it doesn't explain why you voted unfavorable
action
on this.
I think each of us can speak to that individually. I know for myself that we actually just took that vote at our meeting prior to coming here. And one of the reasons was that this board, again, was tasked by this body last year to create these regulations. Even though the committee created them and this board expanded them and supported that expansion, that we personally, that there can't be a competitive advantage for one business over another business. There are other food trucks in town. There have been food trucks this week that have come to town. And so it's kind of one of those things that if we voted to expand it, we should probably support that. And it's one of those all or none type of issues.
So you felt that this expansion would go too far?
No, I think that this expansion would favor one business over other businesses that are also coming to the community.
Okay, I'm not sure I quite understand.
This particular article would allow Nadine's truck to be the only truck on Main Street. There are other trucks coming to town, so there would be a disadvantage to those other trucks that...
Okay. What I think Selectman Watson is trying to say is that Nadine's trucks would be grandfathered.
Yeah.
So future trucks would not have that same advantage. She would be the only one. She would be grandfathered.
So it would be a special case.
Yes, a special privilege.
She'd be the only one allowed on Main Street.
Okay, so, thank you.
So another cupcake truck or other food truck would have a different set of rules to follow. That's the main reason that I think the board voted unfavorable action.
Richard Valenquist, I just want to state I voted unfavorable also for the same reason.
What was the vote on the board, may I ask?
It was 4-1.
4-1. Thank you.
So I think we'll stay here on the left. Please.
Hi, everyone. My name is Morgan Healy. I'm a resident, and I am class of 2008.
Your address, please?
55 Wintergreen Drive.
Thank you.
My job is to ask questions, and I kind of had a burning one after I heard about this case, would be, why is it that her business is any different than any other small business in town, specifically because she does pay for her vehicle, the gas, the stuff that it takes to make her cupcakes and everything, and I don't understand how that is any different than any business owner who, whether it's Jamie's or any other cafe for that matter, that pays rent and keeps up their facility. I just want you to clarify that. I think people probably have that similar question in mind, how her business and what she gives to, whether it's a moving vehicle or a stationary restaurant, I don't see the difference personally. So I just wanted to know that.
Well, the Board of Health in the state of Massachusetts do find them to be very different. For instance, these regulations don't cover ice cream trucks or canteen trucks because the state supersedes that as well. So they're looked at very differently than a stationary business.
Okay, so the health requirements are different. Mm-hmm. You know, I just wanted to know if her truck had not somehow passed health requirements.
Oh, no, no, not at all.
She did pass.
It actually has nothing to do with her. Nadine did everything she was supposed to do in regards to licensing and all of that.
Okay.
I refer back to at this meeting last year, this board was tasked with creating new regulations and a bylaw in regards to a new and emerging industry that was in town. Mm-hmm. So this body tasked us with doing this, and that's exactly what we did. And from doing that, that's how this arose, that she would like to be grandfathered only on Main Street.
Okay.
Are we done? It's not a repartee.
I'm sorry?
It's not a repartee.
I understand. I just really wanted clarification because you said you wanted it to be fair for everyone. So
right. For any other truck that comes to town, they should all be able to do the same thing.
Understandable.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Hi, my name is Kirsten Lovett. I live at 171 Abbott Street. And I am in support of this article, this amendment, because while the Board of Selectmen said that Nadine would be given special privilege if she was grandfathered in here, she knew, did not have these regulations before she started her business. She didn't know that 2 years down the road, these regulations were going to be put in place. Any other food truck that now comes to town knows these regulations before they start their business. And I feel that these regulations would be, have a significant impact on her business and are unfair to her when she has been operating for 2 years following all the town's regulations. Thank you.
We're going to stay on this side of the aisle as they got up first. Please.
Hi, Rebecca Dontremont, 49 Garnet Circle. I will disclose I was asked after being at one of the Board of Selectmen meeting to participate on the Mobile Food Truck Committee as a sole citizen on that committee. I was asked to be on that committee because, similar to Mrs. Pascucci and her opinion on what's fair and just, as a consumer, I want the best product for the best price. That's what competition gives to me. That's what builds a thriving community. I will vote yes on this article in support of Pipe Dream Cupcakes. I do have to say that I felt as though, as a citizen, that I was backed in a corner where this was the only option given to us at the time, because the decision was made for all trucks going forward. So at that point, given that this business was already thriving in this town, the decision was made to amend this article to at least salvage the business that has been thriving here for 2 years. My concern here, and I will say this to the citizens, I know one of the Board of Selectmen has abstained from voting on this. I feel that this reeks of a bias toward the brick and mortars in this town, in my opinion, and I'd like to vote yes in support of Pipe Dream Cupcakes and any other food trucks that will help to create a booming town that we want here in North Andover. Thank you.
Sir.
Mr. Moderator, may I just make a point after those comments?
Please.
So I voted unfavorable action in this article, and I think you are right. It is for a bias toward the brick and mortar. I fully support the brick and mortars. I actually look at my vote on favorable action for this with an eye toward economic development. A lot of times, the Brad Street School is going to be developed. High Street, both sides are now going to be mixed residential and retail spots. Many times in negotiating leases with those spaces, you put in your lease that you're going to be the only vendor of pizza or cupcakes or that sort of thing, and that helps drive economic development. Having a truck, whether it's cupcake truck, a kebab truck, any kind of truck, being able to pull up right in front of your place of business and sell exactly what you're selling, put you at a disadvantage. You can, and you're right, there is overhead with the cupcake truck, I'm sure there is. But to compare it to a brick and mortar overhead, it's not the same. So I voted unfavorable action on this. I stand by what the selectmen set in place for regulations, and I would ask the citizens to, certainly is unfair. The cupcake truck does have a history here, but unfortunately we have to look at all the other trucks that could come into town, park all up and down Main Street and High Street, and I don't think one truck should have special treatment in that sense.
Mr. Moderator, can I just a quick
Please.
Addition? The only addition that I'd like to make to that is, I think that it's very important that we understand that no one is looking to not have Nadine's cupcake truck in town. She's welcome to park on the corner of 1st and Main, 2nd and Main, still in very, very high visibility areas. We're looking at the most congested areas in the community. It's not only taking into account our brick and mortars, which I agree with Selectman Gordon, are absolutely probably part of many of our vote of unfavorable on this, but it's also to a certain degree there's a truck for an hour and a half and you're running in and out of the post office, and it's also just for the convenience of the residents. But again, we are not looking to banish her to Sharpness Pond where nobody goes out. She can park right on First Street in the exact same visibility that she had right in front of Dunkin' Donuts. This is an emerging industry. We're seeing more trucks come to the community. And again, I must remind this body that you were the people who tasked us with this last year because of the emerging issues with these trucks. Thank you, Mr.
Hi,
not
my
Nadine's,
name.
But.
My name is Mark Levin, 195 Amberville Road. I do have a financial stake in the business. I am Nadine's husband.
Thank you for the disclosure.
Thank you. The task, and I'll be very brief, the task force passed a lot of common sense regulations, absolutely. It's my understanding they also limited the number of food trucks, food truck permits that would be granted in the town. So there's a natural cap on that. The food trucks that are coming into the town are coming in for the festivals. They typically are not coming in to park on any of the streets. In High Street and Main Street, there's a lot of transactional business. People run into Dunkin' Donuts. They run into the post office. They may run into Boston Chowder for a quick bite. These are 3 to 5 minute transactions, so there's a lot of turnover. There's very little challenge finding any parking spot on Main Street, so I don't think she's taking business away from the people that want to come and spend 3 hours shopping in the malls of North Andover. I don't see a wave of food trucks, in my opinion, coming to the town. I'm hesitant to, I think it goes down a negative path when we start favoring one business over another. Do we start favoring pizza shops over fast food? Do we start favoring nail salons over dry cleaners? Do we start telling Heavenly Donuts you've got to close an hour earlier than Dunkin' Donuts? It feels like we're somewhat going down a path like that, and that's the path of, you know, where the free market can't thrive, and there are questions about the constitutionality of that. Pipe Dream Cupcakes is good for the town. She's run a very ethical business. She's not parking in front of a restaurant that sells exclusively cupcakes and sitting there for 7 hours. That's not the type of business she runs or wants to run. That's not what she's trying to espouse. She's trying to be brief, provide a service that is trendy, that attracts people to the town. I think she's very good for the development of the town. It's a small business, and we should try to encourage the growth of small business.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Mr. Moderator.
Sir?
Raymond Ahern, 1756 Salem Street. I wonder if the town would consider, in the interest of brick and mortar who pay taxes and the diversity of businesses that would be attracted to the limitations of our downtown area, if the town had 3 commercial parking spaces with a 90-minute parking limit. Would that satisfy both entities and future entities in brick and mortar that may need a truck to come and go?
Okay, no takers. Laura.
Laura McMillan, 143 Carterfield Road. I'd like to ask for clarification on the regulation. Are you saying that there can be no food trucks anywhere on Main and anywhere on High?
Yes.
Okay.
And
I mean, and I think that's it was due to the limitations. It was also we had the police department involved as well. So due to safety, due to the limitations of parking downtown, the transactional processes that do go on that are quick in and out to the to town hall and what have you. And I think, you know, I mean, for me, for as much as I love the cupcake truck, I don't believe in giving a competitive advantage to anyone. And we were tasked with creating these regulations. Again, First Street, Second Street, Waverly, Water, you know, any of the May, all of them are open. It was those areas where they're the quick transitions in and out, as well as the safety of those roads. Those are the busier places currently in our community. But again, for me, the unfavorable goes to the competitive advantage to one. I mean, it allows one truck and then three more come and they can't do it. So if we're going to talk about equal competition, then the playing field should be equal.
We're going to go to the floor.
Hi, I'm Jennifer Rogers. I live at 457 Boston Street. I actually am a real estate attorney. I specialize in retail leasing and been doing it for the last 20 years. The competition that you guys are talking about and this exclusive issue only applies to owners, usually, that own the shopping center. It stops at the limits of the shopping center. It should not be the town's responsibility to dictate what happens on outside of that. And what you are saying is that you're actually favoring certain businesses over other because of where their limitations are. It's not constitutional and it's not fair.
Getting near the exhaustion point, I believe, on this article. Any other questions?
No, but I do have a question, actually. My name
is
Ellen Tamino. I live at 56 Amberville Road. And I'm just confused on what safety concern that you see with her truck parking in the spot she parks in. I thought there was a safety concern. Because, I mean, I visited her truck, and there's not a lot of traffic. I've been to when it's at Jamie's. I've been to...
You asked a question.
Yes.
Does anyone want to answer the question?
We're taking the recommendation of the North Andover Police Department, who sat on the committee with us.
Did they specifically say what their safety concern was?
Well, part of the safety, she does have it on the inside.
Microphone, please.
Sorry, can I say that? Nadine's truck, and again, this article is about Nadine. These regulations are not. And I think that is being lost in this.
I think that's why she's asking to be grandfathered in.
Right, and I don't agree with unfair competition among business. Even some of her supporters are coming up and saying that, well, you're going to favor brick and mortars or we're going to have you, what have you. So for me to favor one food truck over another food truck
is not a repartee.
Sorry.
So to give that competitive advantage, I mean, and again, this body tasked us with doing this last year. We've done what we were asked to do, create regulations, and that's what happened with cooperation of a full committee.
Okay, can I finish, please? I just wanted to say that I vote yes, and I don't see any line of other food trucks lining up to come in North Andover. Nadine was here 2 years ago. She started it, so...
Do we have any new commentary and or questions? Something new.
Ellen Mosier, 137 Cara Drive. Just one question. If the task force was to examine regulations, and I went to the first meeting that you established there was going to be a task force, my question is, why did you go to the extreme and include all of Main Street as well as all of the High Street? And the second part of that question is, when one goes down to make a choice to build the economy down in the North Andover center of town, for the short period when I see on the social media that she is going to be there, my clients and friends all know that I will be by, as well as Nadine, I'll type in an order earlier saying, I'll be there to pick it up, I'm in and out. I go to the other businesses located nearby, whether it's one of the few groomers that are down there, to one of the few dress stores. There's several businesses that are duplicated down there. So the comment also was that you didn't want duplication of products that are being sold. It's all down there. That was one of the comments.
Mr.
Stewart.
Donald Stewart, 52 Prospect Street, 19 years as a selectman. As you know, I don't speak very often in town meeting, and I was the one different vote on this. Nadine started a business with the aspirations of conducting that business. The Board of Selectmen changed the rules in midstream. You should at least give her the grandfather clause. All the talk about traffic and safety is a crock a bowl, okay? So please vote on this now. Let's get on with the meeting.
And I do vote yes.
Excuse me.
Thank you.
Do we have anything new? Any new, not statements of position, any new questions or new considerations?
Mr. Moderator, I don't know if the question was ever answered about why it was extended all the way down Main Street.
Please.
It wasn't.
But it isn't all the way down. It's
well, the actual committee restrictions are from 2nd Street to Sutton Street, that part of Main Street. So obviously above 2nd Street, there's really not much reason to park there. But the reason was because of the additional development that's going on down the end of Main Street, and also the other businesses that are there today and the parking issues that exist on the bottom of Main Street. The board's feeling was that I won't speak for everybody, was that to just limit it to the upper end of Main Street was unfair and not considering the other businesses along Main Street that also have the same parking issues.
Mr. Moderator, if I could also add to that. The committee actually came forth, and it was between the limitation was from 2nd Street to 1st Street, between 1st and 2nd Street. At a selectman's meeting when we were adopting this, it was actually expanded. Selectman Gordon expanded it, taking into account that the Brad Street School will be redeveloped soon, as well as the fire station will also be bringing in 50, upwards of 60 employees when renovated for community development. So these restrictions or regulations were how they came about was not one business over another business, what have you, but it does go back to what Selectman Gordon said, that there is economic development in a plan. Communities don't come back and downtowns don't thrive from them just being done willy-nilly. So we have taken into account and expanded that because of what's happening on Main Street in the future.
There are three people standing, and I understand that we have one online question that is different, so I'm told. So we're going to leave it here. If you only have something new to add, please.
Kevin Breen, 30 Union Street. The point was made that you're providing a competitive advantage, and I would actually argue that since Nadine has been doing business here before these regulations were put in place, you've actually created a competitive disadvantage, and that this amendment actually would allow her to operate under the rules that were in place when she started her business here, and correct that disadvantage that she's been put under. Thank you, sir.
Jamie Jamikowski, 103 Palomino Drive. I'm not here to vilify this group. You were put in charge of a task last year with this new thing that nobody knows about. And I kind of see this odd vision of, you know, the charge of the light brigade of food trucks coming over the horizon invading our town. But be that as it may, I understand in that situation you have to do the best you can with the information that you have at the time. But the fact is, the rules changed. Nadine had a business here, a type of business where she, up to this point, has been allowed to park where she needs to park. And
we've heard this, sir. Do you have something new to add or a specific question?
Yes, I do have something new to add.
Thank you.
I would once again suggest that
do you have something new to add?
I have something new to add.
Please, get to it.
Does the board anticipate further changes and further investigation into this issue of food trucks?
Fair question.
So therefore, would it not make sense to allow somebody to continue to function under the current rules as we continue to develop new rules going forward?
Fair
question.
Mr. Moderator?
Thank you. Please.
Under the current rules, Nadine could not park on Main Street.
Karen Klein, Cricket Lane.
Excuse me, we have a clarification.
But the board does have the purview to reassess rules. I think your question was, could we change it? So if we found that there wasn't a problem or a new set of problems, yes, we can go back and change the rules on the parking. I do need to make a couple of quick clarifications. It is from 2nd to Main, not all of Main, and it is the portion of High from High to Prescott Street. Again, she can park on the corner of Water and High. She can park on the corner of 1st and Main. She can park on the corner of 2nd and Main. So she just can't park on Main. So it's just so that people know that. And what we're voting on, we absolutely support what Nadine is doing. We think it's a wonderful venture, and we're very excited for her. It's just the grandfather. That's what we voted on, is the grandfathering of that one truck. And the other thing, too, people keep saying, well, gee, there's not a parking problem. I think you need to go to the post office
during busy hours. There is a parking problem. And one thing that is not being presented here that we hear all the time, the elderly in North Andover struggle terribly with finding parking spaces because the senior center is right there. So it's not as black and white as it appears. We support Nadine. We support food trucks.
We're going to move this. Do you have something new?
Yes, really quick. Karen Klein, Cricket Lane. What if you just had an amendment to give her 2 years and see how it works, see how many food trucks come in, and then change it?
You can choose to make that amendment if you wish. Okay, we're not hearing that. We have one online question.
Our first online question.
Exactly. Sweet.
I am Caroline Cole. I'm with the League of Women Voters. And I am asking this question on behalf of Andrea O'Donnell, and Andrea lives at 14 Sargent Street. She would like to know, does she idle her vehicle? And if not, what does she use to power her van?
Nadine, I guess you're the best person to answer that question.
That's a good question. My truck is not idle. I have a generator, has very low emissions. It passes the California emissions test, which is the toughest emissions test in the country. So it does not stay idle.
Ladies and gentlemen, I think we're done. Are we ready to vote? We'll try a voice vote. All those in favor of the motion as presented and displayed, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed?
No.
The motion carries. We'll go to three more consent articles, Article 15, 16, and 17. They are articles that, again, require unanimous approval. They are housekeeping articles. Do I hear a motion to move forward? Do I hear a motion? Consent, motion of consent. Any second? All those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, no. The motion carries. We see somebody at the microphone.
Mr. Moderator, Diane Huster, 279 Winter Street. I move reconsideration of all previous articles.
Motion has been made and seconded. It is not debatable. All those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed?
No.
The motion does not carry. Article 18. Yes. 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 Article 15, 16, and 17 were unanimous votes, so that's so declared. Article 18.
Alan Lebovich, Finance Committee, move to adopt Article 18 as printed in the warrant and as displayed on the screen.
Is there a second? The motion is made and seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The motion carries. We have the general fund appropriation. The town manager and the school superintendent are going to be sharing 10 minutes, up to 10 minutes, for a presentation of our $84+ million budget. We'd appreciate your kind attention.
Good evening, everybody. I am Andrew Mailer. I'm your town manager, and as I rise tonight for the first time, I certainly want to welcome you to town meeting. I will present, provided what I hope to be a brief presentation honoring the moderator's 10-minute time limit. Superintendent Hutchison will comment in on a few slides as well relative to the budget, and certainly we are both available for questions as the meeting moves on, or certainly relative to this particular presentation. Bear with me 1 second as I find the appropriate slides. And this is based on the presentation you're having in front of you. So first, I wanted to give you a general overview of the budget. I will hop around a little bit to try to make it through the slides rather quickly, and again, make myself available for any questions. The fiscal 15 general fund budget is $86,503,000. Approximately $84 million of that, when you exclude state assessments or certain items that the town meeting doesn't vote on. It's an increase of $2.9 million, or 3.49%. from last year's appropriation. Notably, there's approximately $1 million requested to fund reserve accounts. $625,000 to the town's general stabilization, $213,000 to the town's capital stabilization. Those will come up in later articles at town meeting, and $175,000 within the school budget to set aside dollars for a special education reserve fund to make sure that we can deliver education when certain issues arise relative to special education cost. The general or baseline school budget increase is 4%. For this year, that means $41,457,000 is recommended for school department funding. This does not include the special education reserve previously mentioned or funding for full-day free kindergarten, which is also in the budget this year. General government funding is recommended at $18,802,000 or 4%. We've added $165,000 into the budget to prepare for the case that we have another difficult winter, which we've had for two of the last 3 years. We've included $223,000 as pay-as-you-go, meaning we're using existing dollars to pay for capital projects. And as you can see, for the balance of that, most of the good year we are facing financially is the result of a conscious decision to change health insurance, to move from our existing products into the Group Insurance Commission, and as a result, there's been significant savings in the budget. The process, so that you understand, and again, bouncing around a little bit, the process that leads us to this date begins back in October when the selectmen have a strategic planning session and identify the goals for the upcoming year. It includes a budget policy statement, which they adopt, moves forward through a five-year financial forecast, which is a joint meeting of the school committee, finance committee, and board of selectmen, and then through dozens of meetings with the finance committee on both the capital plan and the operating budget, until such time as the town meeting warrant is adopted and provided. You will note in this particular budget article that there is unanimous opinion relative to the funding requirements of the school department, the finance committee, myself, and the board of selectmen. To give you a graphical representation of how the costs are split or how the revenue is allocated across our budgets, you see a graph in front of you. If Matt is following along with me, and I know I've made it difficult on him, you see that the largest share is taxes. So real estate taxes in the community constitute approximately 74% of all revenue the town receives. State aid constitutes approximately 11%. And local receipts, which include large items such as motor vehicle excise tax, constitute approximately 10%. The interesting part about this slide is about 10, 12 years ago, the tax component was closer to 67%. So the general percentage of taxes that fund our operating budget has grown dramatically on the tax side, and that's largely a function of the fact that other revenue streams, such as local aid and local receipts, things like excise tax, again, have declined or stayed level due to the economic conditions. And so as a result, you see that the impact on the taxpayers has grown over time. Another image graphically is to look at the allocation of expenditures across the general fund. As you see, education makes up approximately 51% of total spending. The other large categories, public safety is at 12%, employee benefits, even with the change in health insurance that we've made this year, which resulted in savings, constitutes 18%. Notably, if we had not made that change within 10 years, that would have represented 25% of all town spending. Debt service is at approximately 7%, which is a reasonable number and something that myself and the Finance Committee pay particular attention to. And Public Works constitutes approximately 5% of total spending.
Thank you, Andrew. I'd like to present just two slides. The first slide is really about an overview of what drove our budget development, and then the second slide, you'll see the financial explanation of it. One of the main focuses that drove our budget development was how can we attain level one for all our schools. Currently, we only have three schools at level one. Two examples of that within the entire budget is one full-day kindergarten. Providing free full-day kindergarten for all students opens up opportunities that not all students have at this current time. The other example would be reading. We expanded development of reading for elementary schools, and that will again enhance the learning of all students, allow us to get to level one in the different schools. Another theme was sustainability. I think you've heard that in the town often from the town manager. And two examples of that, when we looked at school obligations, one of the questions was, can this be sustained? And if it could not be sustained, we didn't do it. The second one is special education funding. If we are to sustain our budget around special education. We had to set aside specific funds so that we can do that, so we don't have to dig into a hole and go in the red. So that was why we had to set aside special funds for special education. The other pieces were a strategic plan together with the school committee directives. There's a number of points there, too many to put up on screen right now. But when we develop our strategic plan, we always ask ourselves in the budget development, how does the budget support us achieving that strategic plan? And then the final one is, schools are all about teaching and learning, and that's what curriculum is all about. And so when we looked at the budget, we also asked, how can we do something that will distribute a more equitable support for curriculum development across the district? And that hits especially on professional development and also how we use data to impact instruction. And the second example is simply technology. We are running short and behind on technology. This budget this year shows a dramatic increase of funding towards technology. The next slide simply brings forth to you what it looks like in the budget. With a 4% increase up to over $41 million, 3% of that increase is simply for level services keeping with budget neutral changes. There were a number of changes we made, but they were budget neutral within that, within the level services. So we took what we would have had for our level services and we did some changes within that. One example is the high school department chairs. We've now eliminated high school department chairs and we have a K through 12 curriculum support. And we've used those funds that we would put just for the high school into across the entire district. The other 1% simply allows us to implement more support for elementary reading and the technology replacement program. Now the funding for full day kindergarten improves education and results in increased revenues in the town in future years. So that support for the 1 year extraordinary support to get us to free full day kindergarten is necessary, yet it also results in increased town revenue. Thank you.
We spent 39 minutes on cupcakes. I'm going to allow the manager another couple of minutes on our $84 million budget.
I have no comment. What I want to transition next to is the enterprise funds. Certainly, as you proceed through the budget process, it's important to understand what's happening with our enterprise funds. Enterprise funds, by statute, are self-supporting from the fees that are generated by those systems, most notably the water and sewer utility systems, but also here in North Andover, the Stevens Estate is operated as an enterprise fund, a self-supported fund. But the good news, I've combined those together relative to a slide. The total spending in the enterprise funds over three budgets, which you will be asked to take action on after the general fund budget, totals $10,618,000. The breakdown follows, water at $5.6 million, sewer at $4.7 million, the Stevens Estate just south of $300,000. It should be noted that $600,000 is being taken from the water retained earnings account for the purpose of making pay-as-you-go capital. So we had an expenditure that'll come up in the capital plan of approximately $600,000, but we're using existing proceeds to pay for that. So we neither have to borrow it, nor do we have to raise rates for the purpose of making sure we make those improvements to the water treatment plant. The increase to the three funds, which total $10,600,000, is $124,000. We don't account for that transfer of $600,000, which is a modest 1.3% in fiscal 15 from fiscal 14. And the water and sewer rates, as proposed in the articles that come up, would remain unchanged for the third consecutive year if the budgets as proposed are adopted. We again have seen a third straight year of profitability on the Stevens Estate, and I think that's notable, something the Finance Committee commented on last year. The fact that we've been able to turn the corner on the Stevens Estate and make it a viable business entity is important to the community at large. To give you a breakdown, a quick graphical breakdown of where we allocate the cost for enterprise funds, you see this somewhat boring chart relative to the enterprise funds, and it just gives you the larger categories. Indirect costs are costs borne by the general fund, which are paid for by the enterprise funds. Direct costs are what you think they would be. GLSE references the Greater Lawrence Sanitary District, so we pay them to treat the town sewage and debt service. Constitutes 35%, down from 45% last year, with a goal to eventually bring that down to 25%. And finally, I think it's worthwhile, if the moderator gives me some tolerance, to review what we've just talked about in the last 10 minutes or so. It has been the focus of the school administration, the Board of Selectmen, the Finance Committee, and myself the focus on sustainability, stewardship, and strategic planning, and this budget, and the budgets that come after it, quite frankly, through our five-year financial forecast, are intended to do exactly that. So highlights, modifications to employee retiree health insurance plans have resulted in the significant savings we proposed. It has made fiscal 15 an easier year. The real challenge is, a real struggle is, of the crossroads moment we have is, do we choose to take the available dollars created by that one-time benefit and spend it all and find ourselves in a particularly difficult spot in fiscal 16 and 17? Well, this budget, with the support of the Finance Committee and the Board of Selectmen and the School Committee, doesn't do that. It recognizes that we only can go to that well one time relative to health insurance, and we should take the opportunity to provide reasonable increases to the budget while at the same time be mindful of the costs rising in the future and make sure we plan accordingly to make sure that we can stay on the sustainable path. Even taking that modest path, some successes in this year's budget are the school reading program, the full-day free kindergarten, and increased library staffing. The budget is structurally balanced. For the third straight year, we are not recommending water and sewer rate increases, and we're maintaining the course will significantly improve our ability to maintain or enhance service levels during the next 10 years. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Manager and Dr. Hutchinson. Now it's time, we've heard the presentation of the budget, it's time for a motion. For the benefit of people who are not aware, the Finance Committee has the responsibility of making a recommendation to the meeting, and they'll do so now and make a motion if they choose.
Move to adopt Article 19 as printed in the handout and as displayed on the screen. Raise and appropriate funds for fiscal year 2015 as presented under the column entitled Board of Selectmen and Finance Committee and Town Manager recommend. General Government, $2,236,400.
It's not necessary for you to read that. It's on the screen.
Oh, okay, fine, okay. Great. That's all right.
Does the Finance Committee have any comment that they'd like to make relative to the motion?
No, I think it was a good process this year. I think it's a balanced budget, and I think we're wisely using the funds that have been generated by the moving to the new health care plan.
Thank you. Is there any discussion on the budget? Sir.
Mr. Moderator, John.
Excuse me. We have a motion. Let's make sure we have a second. Second. Motion has been made and seconded. Thank you so much.
Mr. Moderator, John Fooey, 71 Paddock Lane. I have a question for Dr. Hutchinson.
Please.
I was wondering if he could further explain the connection between the implementation and funding of full-time a full-day kindergarten and increase in future town revenues. Thank you.
Sure. Part of that's connected to, for every student, we receive an allocation from the state in Chapter 70. And when you move students from half day to full day, you can claim twice the amount. And therefore, you get that return. You don't get the entire 680 the first year, but it works up towards that. So that in 3 years' time, you begin to see increased revenue. So, but you have to be able to go 1 year with town support that's not funded from revolving accounts that come from tuition. So that, and you see, the state is asking us to move towards that, but the towns have to be ready and cities have to be ready to fund that for a year so that we don't charge tuition. If we charge tuition, we can't claim the amount for a full-time student. We can only claim a half amount because we are required to provide half-day kindergarten. But the other half we have to charge right now. And if we charge, then we can't get the full claim on Chapter 70. Yep.
Welcome back.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Jennifer Goldman, 112 Amberville. How many questions am I allowed?
Let's start with one for the moment.
If I felt that the $175,000 you've listed for special education is not enough money, what is the recourse?
I'll answer that question. You would have the right to ask the school committee by direction to spend more money and make a motion, but they unilaterally, under the law, get to determine where and how they spend the total money. All you can do in the school budget is have a grand total. You cannot direct the school committee where to spend it, but the town meeting can suggest to the school committee where it should be spent.
Mr. Moderator, point of clarification?
Yes.
The $175,000 is a reserve in cases where other special education dollars that are within the budget are exceeded. So the total dollar value in spending on special education far exceeds $175,000. This is a set aside. So if for some reason the total cost of special education that is contained in the school budget is exceeded for some reason, mm-hmm. and I know not a district placement as an example, they wouldn't have to take the funds from other non-special education line items. So this is a reserve for the purpose of taking care of the exceptional. It is not the total spending on special education.
Clearly not.
Okay. May Please. I follow up?
Yes.
A normal budget is not a reserve. It lists all costs budgeted for that Correct. Line item. So now I'm confused about the entire document.
I don't understand your question.
Okay. When you run a company, which I do, your budget is not the reserves you set aside, it's the total cost you expect for the future year.
Right.
So basically you're saying $680,000 for full day kindergarten is reserve. It is not the cost of running full day kindergarten.
The question was about special education.
So
the total, to the moderator's point, the total amount that's in that line item, I don't have it directly in front of me, $42 million yes. and change.
Yes.
Is fully allowed by the school committee and the superintendent to spend to the bottom line under ed reform. That is their right. For the purpose of showing it in the warrant, we have indicated what would have been the traditional sort of increased amount, that's the $41 million figure, isolated and showed and displayed for the benefit of town meeting members, $680,000, that is the cost of full-day free kindergarten, and $175,000 as a supplement to the school budget for the purpose of protecting against unusual circumstances that may arise due to special education.
Okay.
They are allowed to spend to the bottom line, but for the purposes of display, if you look to the actual motion that's presented up there, the total amount done to school, I'm sorry, I'm blinded by this light, but it's approximately $42 million.
Yeah.
That total is what the school department will have as funding. For the purpose of demonstrating and being transparent to town meeting, we've identified those costs in the detail of the warrant.
Okay.
They have the full bottom line to spend to under ed reform.
Okay. Thank you.
Sir?
Mr. Moderator, Ted Tripp, 262 Boston Street. Under state assessments, it has Essex County Agricultural Assessment, and we've gone from $37,000 to $90,000 from last year to proposed the coming year. Can somebody explain why it's gone up so much, and can we expect another doubling or more next year?
That's a great question. As many of you may be aware, the Essex Aggie School combined with the North Shore Voc Tech, and there is new facility being constructed currently in Middleton near the sheriff, near the jail location. We, as a result of that, we're expecting some transition. In fact, have seen some migration of the student population, an increase in enrollment for that particular facility. That fluctuates year to year, Mr. Tripp. I wouldn't expect that that's a trend. It's not uncommon when you open new school facilities that you will see some change. By the way, as it relates to the dollar value, that could be between 37 and 90, 3-4 students. It wouldn't take much under the cost per pupil to drive that number between 37 and 90. So we've seen an increase in enrollment, but I wouldn't expect that trend to continue.
So this is because we're being assessed per pupil that attend the school?
Correct.
Okay, thank you.
Do we have any other queries? Hearing none, I think we're ready for a vote on our budget. Article 19 has been moved as presented on the screen. All those in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? No. The motion passes unanimously. Congratulations all. Article 20, 21, and 22 are consent articles. If there's no objection, they're all appropriations relative to enterprise funds, as we heard earlier displayed in the presentation. Is there a motion?
Move to adopt Articles 20, 21, and 22 as printed in the warrant and displayed on the screen.
The motion is made and seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? It is a unanimous vote. Article 23, Capital Improvement Plan for the fiscal year. We're going to hear a presentation. I'm going to give the moderator excuse me, the manager. Would you like this job, Mr. Manager? Shall we trade?
No. I'm good where I am.
Okay, thank you. As am I think. We'll give him up to 10 minutes for this presentation.
I'm back again. I hopefully give you a thoughtful overview of where we stand relative to our capital plan. Certainly the budget, which is $86 million, constitutes a significant part of what happens in government, both in education and general government. But the capital plan in many ways is the lifeblood of every community. It represents what we're doing with our infrastructure, our decision to invest in our facilities and make sure that the quality of life in the community continues. This is a beautiful community, and the more attention we pay to making sure that our assets are maintained and improved, the more we are being stewards of the future of future generations of North Andover. And the capital plan is exactly that product. And I'll give you a general overview for 2015. First of all, a general definition. There are different ways that capital plans can come before town meeting. They can certainly, by style, it could be three types of purchases: a physical asset like an ambulance or a street sweeper, an improvement to an asset, for instance, like public building repair or street paving, or the construction of a physical asset, good example being the Kittredge Gym, which we're very pleased to see rising out of the ground not far from here. Any project in excess of any of these categories in excess of $25,000 is by definition considered a capital project. So how do we fund these capital projects? I'm going to show in the next slide the different ways that they would fall before town meeting, but first it's important to understand why we have a capital plan. And although you see in front of you a single plan, the fiscal 2015 plan, it's important to note what gets provided to the Board of Selectmen and what also gets provided to the Finance Committee is a five-year capital plan. And it's not just a five-year capital plan where we idly put down figures for 16 and 17 and 18 and 19. They really do integrate. We expect when departments submit requests and we evaluate requests that those requests understand how one project dovetails into another. So if you have an opportunity someday, look at the five-year plan. It'll give you a sense of what's happening in the community, not only in this year, but also into the future. So here's the different ways that a capital item, as defined in the first slide, can come before town meeting. First is the annual capital improvement plan. By charter, that is recommended by myself. It's reviewed by the Selectmen and Finance Committee, and I'm pleased to announce tonight that the capital improvement plan comes with unanimous adoption or approval of those three bodies, including the school committee. Can also appear in the annual operating budget. The budget you just approved will have smaller capital line items or smaller capital items within it. For instance, a police car would likely appear in a budget rather than a capital plan like we're talking about this evening. Town meeting articles, you can have a separate article that funds a capital improvement project. We do not have any this year, but that certainly would be another method. And the Community Preservation Act, which you will discuss at a later time, also will have items which traditionally qualify as a capital improvement. This gives you the criteria, the method by which we evaluate projects. Again, the charter identifies the town manager as responsible for developing the capital improvement plan. I rank all of those requests that come before my office in a number of categories. There's actually a numbering system to make sure that we're considering all those requests and we prioritize them in a way that is appropriate and thoughtful. There are different ways we can fund these projects, the use of bonds and grants, operating revenue and free cash. And again, it's a five-year plan. It's not just about this year, it's about planning for the future as well. We do have a goal, and we're working toward achieving it, have in fact achieved it in this current year, and that is to have total debt service associated with the capital plan not exceed 5% of our operating budget. The importance of that is the more debt service you have to your operating budget, the less flexible your operating budget becomes. So the fiscal 2015 general fund has 13 requests for funding, total $8,991,000. Grants, basically donations, transfers from the state, I wish they were donations, right? Money that comes from the state that we do not have to pay back in the form of grants constitutes $775,000. Operating revenue, other accounts that we have in town pay for $223,000. Net borrowing of the total project is approximately $7.9 million. That'll be in the form of debt service. We issue bonds, and that debt service gets paid by the operating budget of the community. Some highlights, and I know this is fairly small, and I apologize. One is the CIP for 2015 has unanimous support of the Board of Selectmen, the Finance Committee, myself, Superintendent, school, and the School Committee as well. Again, highlights total investment in our roadways in fiscal 15 include $1,565,000, including $650,000 for improvements to Water and High Street, significant upgrade in that area around the mills. Technology enhancements for both school and general government, something we've continued to invest on and will continue to invest in over the next 5 years, nearly $1 million in technology to make sure we keep pace, both from an educational perspective and an operational perspective. A nice benign item like a six-wheel dump truck at $78,000. We're investing more and more in building maintenance to make sure we maintain the buildings properly, and that investment is $675,000. The item at the bottom of that page will represent most of what I'm going to talk about on the balance of the slide, and that is the facility master plan. Back in 2010, this town meeting supported the idea of forming a committee and providing them with the resources to hire a consultant to take a long-range view of the community's physical assets, its bricks and mortar, to develop a plan that would carry us forward. Now, it's really interesting. It's often not only in North Andover, certainly, but in many communities that we develop a lot of these plans. We often kid that government develops plans and we produce another plan, and in the end, facilities plans are not any different than that. I think what makes this particular plan unique is not only did a committee roll out a thoughtful plan that looked into the future, but this town meeting in 2012 and 2013 recognized the importance of funding that plan. And so the facility master plan is underway, and aggressively underway. If you travel around the community, you'll see again the new Kittredge Gym rising out of the ground behind the Kittredge School, something that we needed to build 50 years ago is being built now. The former police department was demolished recently, and what will rise out of that is a new school administration building. And without boring you the details of this particular slide, this is the seven different phases of the facility master plan that was presented to this board in 2012. And each of those projects are significant. They relate to space needs, programmatic needs, setting aside the need to pay rent, and so forth. And so between now and 2018, we will come back every year, present the plan, and ask for funding in that particular year. And the real unique part about this particular plan, which is truly unusual, the $25 million for the facility master plan will be funded with inside the capital plan, with no need for a tax override. We are taking care of our own facilities and not asking the taxpayer to come back and fund what we should be taking care of on our own. As you note from the slide, phase one is complete. You funded that in 2012. Phase two is complete, and phase two is underway. And phase three, which is about what I'm gonna present now, is where we are today in terms of asking you for funding. What is phase three? Well, you may recall last year by unanimous vote, this town meeting supported a $660,000 expenditure to design a new fire station, to replace a 1908 vintage station that was built on Main Street at a time where it made perfect sense to build on Main Street. There's been a number of studies, a 1994 study, a 1972 master plan, a continued study in 2003, all about replacing a fire station. We've found a way to do it. We've found a way to do it by building it inside of a master plan and not asking you for tax override to fund it. And your support last year for the design has brought us here today. We're ready to go. We need your support, and as proposed last year, we need approximately $5.9 million in spending to build a brand new fire station that will service the needs of our community 50 years into the future, instead of worrying about how to continue to maintain the second floor of an existing station that was originally designed to house the hay for the horses that were parked inside the facility. The second piece of this particular phase is, in my opinion, equally important. When the new fire station is constructed, we will design the improvements up to the current fire station to bring back into one location town hall services. Currently, about 50% of town hall services are housed at 1600 Osgood. That means if you want to go get a building permit and go to the clerk's office, you arrive at town hall, you go to the clerk's office, you get your car in those limited parking spots, and you drive 3 miles up to 1600 Osgood. And you'll get a cupcake too. But more seriously, but today that's not the way any business. I heard some of the interesting comments about how business should operate. It is no way to run a business to take a number of your services and spread them out across the town, to make it more difficult for patrons to figure out where the heck government is located. And certainly if we are going to jumpstart Main Street and make a viable business entity, it would make most sense to bring more people to the business that is government down on Main Street. So although it is secondary in terms of the context of the importance of building a fire station here next year, it is not insignificant, because when that fire station gets built, we'll be prepared to move forward with improving the space that was the former fire station into a place downtown that'll be the kind of location for government you would expect. So contained in the fiscal 14, phase three, excuse me, fiscal 15, and the request in front of you is to fund not only the construction of a new fire station, but also the town hall as well. I've included some general pictures for those of you who don't know what the fire station looks like. This is the 1908 picture. I would say that the notable difference between the 1908 and the now picture is I like the doors better in the 1908. And that it was on the second floor that hay was kept for the horses. That is currently the bunking quarter for a 24/7 highly professional department that doesn't have the ability to train, maintain their equipment, or operate.
Is that third carriage a cupcake?
Could be. I'm not going there. So, in all seriousness, we have a tremendous fire department and emergency management services that go with that department. What we don't have is the facilities to make sure they can deliver the services we need when we need them. This is a 1908 building. I have 100 pictures I was going to display, but you would have been bored with me and probably thrown me out of the room. But if you saw what the facility looked like, not from a maintenance perspective, but from the perspective of trying to deliver such an important service, you would be appalled. And that's not your fault. That's a function of not finding a way to do the right thing over time. We now have the plan. We have the method of funding it. And now is the time to build what will be a future station, at least in some general reference. Will pop up on the screen shortly. I'm pretty sure Matt's going to do that for me. And this will be the station which is proposed on Chickering Road. You approved that in an earlier article, and I appreciate it. The transfer of the land. This station can be built within the budget proposed. It will be state-of-the-art. It will be in a location that the fire chief and others have approved as being appropriate for public safety. And in the end, it'll serve the community better and more effectively than what we have today. In summary, as it relates to that particular plan, I would say that I very much appreciate the effort by town meeting starting in 2010 and then in 2012 and 13 for recognizing the benefit of long-term planning and recognizing the importance of investing in infrastructure. Finally, and very quickly, the enterprise funds also have capital projects. There are only two of them, and those constitute a total of $678,000. You will note that $600,000 of improvements to the water system are being funded out of the retained earnings. I had mentioned that previously. The purpose of that is to use existing reserves to fund capital improvements to make sure that we can hold water and sewer rates in check. I appreciate the indulgence of time, Mr. Moderator, and I'm all done.
Thank you. So we've heard the report, now that we're in need of a motion so we can consider the actions that have been suggested by the town manager.
Mr. Moderator, move to adopt Article 23 as printed in the warrant and as displayed on the screen.
The motion has been made and seconded. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, we'll move to the vote. It requires a two-thirds vote, so make your voices strong. All those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed?
Yes.
It passes by a two-thirds vote. Article 24. Do we have a motion?
Yes, Mr. Moderator.
Mr. Simons.
I make a motion to approve Article 24 as displayed on the screen.
Is there a second to the motion? The motion has been made and seconded. Is there any discussion? Hearing no discussion, we'll move to a vote. All those in favor of the motion, please say aye. Those opposed? The motion passes unanimously. Article 25.
Move to adopt Article 25 as printed in the warrant and is displayed on the screen.
The motion has been made and seconded. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? A two-thirds vote is necessary. I declare it unanimous. And we'll move to Article 26.
Move to transfer $1 million from the Health Insurance Trust Fund to the OPED Stabilization Fund.
Is there a second? Motion is made and seconded. Is there any discussion? This also requires a two-thirds vote. All those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? I declare it a unanimous vote. Article 27.
Move to raise and appropriate or transfer funds from available funds or free cash a sum of $213,000 into the Capital Stabilization Fund.
The motion is made and seconded. Is there any discussion?
Excuse me.
I'm sorry, yes, I apologize.
My name is Glenn Aspisley, 1132 Salem Street. I just wanted to clarify in one of the previous motions, if that's okay.
One of the previous motions, meaning not this article?
Yeah, it went by so quickly.
I'm sorry, we can't do that. But if you, I'll allow you the indulgence of declaring to me anyway what was concerning to you. Which article?
The community preservation article.
Yes.
You had displayed something on the screen. I just wasn't clear if that was printed in the warrant because it was went by much too fast to read.
It was printed in the warrant and also supplemented in the back of the meeting in a handout. Is that correct, Mr.
That's
Simons?
Correct, yes.
Yes. I'm All sorry, right. we cannot...
I'll look for it. Thanks.
Thank you. I'm sorry we can't go back to it. We're on Article 27. Any discussion of Article 27? All those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It is a unanimous vote. Article 28.
Move to raise and appropriate or transfer funds from available funds or free cash a sum of $625,000 into the stabilization fund.
Is there a second? The motion is made and seconded. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, this requires a two-thirds vote. All those in favor of the motion, please say aye. Those opposed, it is a unanimous vote. Article 29.
Mr. Moderator?
Yes.
As the petitioner has submitted a letter stating he will not be bringing the motion to the floor and is recommending the community take no action on this matter, therefore I move to take no action on Article 29.
The motion has been made and seconded. Is there discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? We move on to Article 30.
Mr. Moderator?
Yes, sir.
I move to adopt Article 30 as printed in the warrant and as displayed on the screen.
Article 30 has been moved. Is there a second? The motion is made and seconded. Is there any discussion? We have something that's not in the warrant book, and that is the recommendation of the Board of Selectmen. I understand they've made one.
Board of Selectmen recommends favorable action.
And the Planning Board had previously
recommends favorable action.
Recommended favorable action. Any discussion, ladies and gentlemen? Hearing none, this requires a two-thirds vote. All those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? It is a unanimous vote. Article 31.
Mr. Moderator, I move to adopt Article 31 as printed in the warrant as displayed on the screen.
Article 31 has been moved. Is there a second?
Second.
The motion has been made and seconded. I understand that the Board of Selectmen, not printed in the warrant, has made a recommendation.
Favorable action.
Favorable action and?
And Mr. Moderator, the Planning Board also recommends favorable action.
Do we have any discussion? It begs a joke here, but I guess I'll be quiet. All those, we're ready to move the question?
No.
All those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? I hear, let's do that again. All those, needs two-thirds vote. All those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? I declare it a two-thirds vote. Article 32.
Mr. Moderator, yeah. I move to adopt Article 32 as printed in the warrant and as displayed on the screen.
Article 32 has been moved. The Board of Selectmen have a recommendation.
Favorable action.
Okay.
And the Planning Board also recommends favorable action.
Have we any discussion? Hearing no discussion, this requires a two-thirds vote. All those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? I declare a two-thirds vote. That was our penultimate article. I'd like to thank you all for your attention. Before all our eyes droop to an early close for the night, I'd like to thank the town clerk and her extraordinary staff, all of the tellers, the town IT director, Matt Killen, the North Andover Community Access Director, Brian Frazier, our online monitoring staff. I'd like you to join me in please saying thank you to them. Article 33.
Mr. Moderator, I move to adopt Article 33 as printed in the handout and as displayed on the screen.
Article 3 is moved. Is there a second? The motion has been made and seconded. We have a recommendation from the Board of Selectmen. I'm sorry? It's in your book. It has been amended. Can we not see? Go ahead. So I'm going to beg your indulgence, and I'm going to ask Mr. Simons at his seat to tell us briefly if there's been any material change.
The changes really from what was originally printed are not material. They've actually, what they've done is they've tightened it up to make it, the language slightly more restrictive so that the planning board has a certain amount of discretion, but it's a limited amount of discretion in terms of the uses allowed in this district.
Are we satisfied? We can take a moment. Okay, hearing no need for discussion, I'll move the vote. It requires a two-thirds vote. All those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, the motion passes unanimously. Ladies and gentlemen, that brings us at 9 o'clock to the end of our meeting. All kudos and appreciation to you. And I ask Ms. Smedili.
Mr. Moderator, I move that this 2014 annual town meeting be dissolved.
The motion has been made and seconded. Is there any discussion? All those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The meeting is so dissolved. Thank you all for your attention. Much appreciated. Thank you very much.